You all look wonderful. It's wonderful to stand up here and look at all of you. You are part of a tremendous legacy. For in the lore of the history of this congregation, it is written that when the city of Everett came into being in 1891, some early settlers who entered the scene as members of the Episcopal Church wanted to be able to worship with the services of a clergyman. In those days, it was definitely a clergyman. In 1892, then, an itinerant missionary priest by the name of James Cheel held the very first service that they were able to organize in the unfinished store on Riverside. A series of clergymen continued the weekly services, so the first community rented Gamble's Hall until a more permanent arrangement could be established. And soon enough, on April 24, 1892, the Reverend John Bowes Hill of St. Luke's Church in Tacoma presided at the service before meeting with a group of 34 members in order to outline the steps they had to follow towards canonically becoming a parish. And soon thereafter, the first officers were elected, who sent Bishop John Paddock a petition for admission as a mission within the ministry of the District of Olympia, which was itself at that time considered a missionary district and not yet a diocese. Just 1 week later, on May 1st, 1892, Trinity's treasurer, George Hutchings, the very first one in a long line of treasurers to come, reported that they had collected $1,215 and that Charles Fratt of the Everett Land Company had contributed 4 lots of land located on the southwest corner of Wedmore Avenue and California Street. And so just 6 weeks after that, on Trinity Sunday, June 12th, so they've gone from April to June, church warden George Sherry announced that the members had acquired all the assets that they needed to become incorporated as a parish in just a few months. The very first vestry included a fellow by the name of Mr. N.M. Neld, who proposed the name Trinity for the new parish, and the vestry then called Daniel G. McKinnon as their first rector. During the following months, just 2 months, a building was erected at that property on Wedmore in California, and the first service in that first church building was held on August 28, 1892. In just 5 months, Trinity had transformed from an idea in the minds of a few into a tangible reality all on its own. But the East Coast clergy, who dared to travel out here to the Wild West, were not usually prepared for the unique challenges of the Pacific Northwest environment and to wrestle the very libertarian personalities of the very powerful industry of men serving on the vestry, who were used to being the people who were in charge. Until 1911, Trinity's rectors changed every 2 to 4 years. But the last of those was a fellow, the Reverend Lewis Tucker, who detailed the utter misery of his experiences of Everett and his vestrymen in a book called Clerical Errors. Published in 1910. About the weather, he wrote, quote, "It mists, it drizzles, it sprinkles and sobs, and fogs, and sighs, and snivels." Meanwhile, his vestrymen, he complained bitterly, quote, "They have provided me a cassock, and a single robe worn and abandoned by former rectors, and I expect that I shall, and expect somehow that I shall be able to live on less than $1.50 a week. They are not troubled by my lack of comfort, much less by how my family is expected to eat. They seem to believe that I ought to be able to manifest miracles of multiplied loaves and fishes on a daily basis. Lewis tried. He tried bringing more members in order to increase revenue and possibly his salary. He estimated that upwards of 1,000 Episcopalians had arrived to settle in Everett, but only 100 were on his parish roll. But in spite of his ordeals, he managed to at least visit another 300 prospective new households in his efforts to recruit Episcopalians. But he remained frustrated about the remaining 600 that he knew must be out there, but seemed to be hiding from him. He wrote, "Even the best shepherd cannot find a lost sheep unless it bleat." While Lewis was the rector of Trinity, the missionary district in Western Washington became the Diocese of Olympia in 1910, while Frederick M. Peter was its bishop. And the following year, in 1911, the Trinity Vestry called the Reverend Edgar M. Rogers, who was then living in Port Angeles. Within his first year as rector, Father Rogers had led the vestry to purchasing the property at 23rd and Point, breaking ground on the former parish hall, which used to be just slightly that way of us, on March 25th, 1912. He presided at the first service in that hall only 6 months later, on September 8th. Additionally, a rectory was purchased and entirely paid for by the women of the church. Obviously, Edgar Rogers had a much more agreeable personality and winning leadership style than poor Lewis before him. Within 3 years of Father Rogers' arrival, the membership roll recorded 286 communicants. During the years of World War I, Trinity was an active hub for community organizing and the efforts of the war, hosting Red Cross meetings, adopting war orphans, Liberty Bonds, and they're selling Liberty Bonds, and hosting an array of guest wartime speakers and faith leadership dignitaries from all over the world, including Belgium, France, Greece, and Russia. 65 members of Trinity served in active duty during the First World War. When the war was over and laborers returned to their homes and work, members of the church laid the cornerstone of our sanctuary that you can still see when you go out to that corner on 23rd and Point near our original entry, which was dedicated by Bishop Peter and inscribed the church as a victory memorial. After the cornerstone was laid by the bishop and members of the congregation, those assembled sang a song out of the new church hymnal of 1892 called "Our Father's Gone to Thee." The melody would have been familiar to them since it was adapted from the British national anthem, "God Save the Queen." But the lyrics of our national anthem also go to that same tune, "My Country, 'Tis of Thee." In countries not previously part of the British Empire, the tune of "God Save the Queen" has provided the basis for an array of patriotic songs, though generally it is connected with great ceremony. The melody is also used for the national anthem of Liechtenstein, which is called "Oben am Grünen Rhein." The tune goes at least as far back as the 1600s in England, a significant period in the formation of the Church of England and the history of our Episcopal Church. Bishop Peter had just returned to the United States following the sixth Lambeth meeting held in our church's history, a gathering of bishops at Lambeth, England. out the sense of fellowship with the Archbishop of Canterbury and the 252 bishops present at that gathering, representing the Anglican Communion, as well as the American commitment to Britain during World War I, would no doubt inform the choice of that particular hymn, Our Father's God to Thee. In honor of that same connection with the Anglican Communion that we have today, as well as a connection to those who dedicated this building, we will be singing Our Father's God to Thee as the concluding hymn of our service today. Our building is also physically connected to our Scottish lineage of the Episcopal Church's first consecrated bishop, Samuel Seabury, by the presence of a piece of marble from the island of Iona, contributed by parishioners and placed within the cornerstone that was laid by Bishop Peter. When the old church property at Wetmore in California was sold, those funds helped to support the work of the architect of this building, E.T. Osborne, while the stained glass windows were designed and executed by Charles J. Common. Additionally, the pews and woodwork, were carved of Australian gum wood under the direction of Captain Bramwell in the workshop of the American Tugboat Company. So if you feel like you're sailing away underneath you, you know why. The final dedication of this new building was held on Trinity Sunday, May 22nd, 1921, and it included 17 baptisms by Bishop Peter, the first child to be baptized. Right there was the granddaughter of Mr. and Mrs. C.D. Pratt. Father Rogers celebrated his 25th anniversary at Trinity in 1936, and when he died suddenly of a heart attack on May 21st, 1941, he had served for 30 years and remains remembered today as a generous, kind man who served as a fatherly figure to generations of Episcopal children and as a spiritual benefactor to many beyond the doors of his church. Though others would follow him as rector, his spirit continues to remain in the collective memories and hearts of the Everett community. Our story, our history, includes the impact of world wars and foreign wars, which generations of our membership have known and lived through. Through the story of the timing of when this building was created, within the contents of its cornerstone, the history of the gift of labor and treasures too many to mention here, by people intent to build up even in the midst of some of the greatest challenges this community and our nation have known. Trinity has done more than endure. It has committed itself to living from the promise of resurrection through every generation. The stained glass windows created by Connick, which overlook our high altar, were designed by him with the theme of resurrection in mind. The risen Christ is depicted on that center panel, with Mary as mother to the left and Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James on the outside left panel. To the right of Christ is Peter. To the far right is Joseph. The middle panel depicting the resurrected Christ was given by the children of the parish in honor of mothers. Surrounded by doves and angels, with Roman soldiers giving up their arms at his feet, the resurrected Christ raises a hand in blessing, etched in glass, immortalized in color and light. This blessing reminds us every time we behold it that there is no challenge so great that together we cannot overcome it. Our spiritual ancestors before us, over the past 125 years, we too, like them, have our dreams. We too have the ability, just as they did, to realize our dreams as a community. Like them, we must gather together in the common cause of creating something new in the wilderness of our time, a community of gathered hearts intent on the purposes of God's love, intent on making the world kinder and less violent, intent on healing divisions until only mutual understanding remains, intent on feeding bodies, hearts, and minds with the realization of peace, intent on living from our baptismal promises to strive for justice and peace and respect the dignity of every human being. Lest we forget, which is inscribed on our dedication plaque, lest we forget, we are here on this good earth as the resurrected body of Christ, not to engage in conflict, but to render all the mechanisms of conflict impotent by our insistence upon the embodiment of God's love given to us through God, in Christ, and by the Spirit. For when we love one another, allowing nothing and no one to divide us, we are the living water of our faith that is poured out in unrestrained abundance by the resurrected Christ, giving life to those who thirst with us for a better world. When we love God and love Christ as Christ loves us, we do the work of the Holy Spirit that dwells within us. When we love. Truly, truly then, my friends, we are Trinity. In Christ's name.